You came at the right time. Think back about when the iPhone just launched.
Today, Apple is going to reinvent the phone.
The people who started early, they defined a new era. They were the first ones on the App Store and probably became millionaires. And the same is happening now for AR and VR technologies as well.
I am excited to announce Oculus Quest.
So today, I'm excited to announce an entirely new AR platform with a revolutionary new product. And here it is.
AR and VR, and I will now just call them immersive technologies to put them together, are the next big wave of how we as humans interact with technology. And the demand is growing, there will be new opportunities, and it is still a very, very fresh field that is just taking off. So this is your chance to be part of something huge, a big wave. You can ride the wave. And in this video, I want to talk about how you can get into the field in the fastest way possible, without wasting any time on random tutorial hell or something like this. So let's get started. When I started with VR development, I already had some Unity experience. So that was my game engine I just went with and stick with it. Because you don't want to dabble around like 50 different game engines. I mean, there are only like two big ones anyway for AR and VR, either Unity or Unreal. At least like that is what 99% of people will recommend. And that is also the industry standard. So try out both, pick one and then stick with it. And really try building your portfolio and everything to actually show your proof of competence. It's really more about the depth and not the width. And you can definitely also, again, like learn more stuff in other engines and try out stuff over time as well. But for now, I think it's really helpful not to dabble around too much. I think this applies even more to general programming, where you have like hundreds of languages you can dabble into. And for XR, it's a bit easier in quotes because there's not so much choice really. But especially also for programming, if you're not into XR right now, then just stick with like one language and let's just like try to learn it. In that case, Python would be pretty good as well. But again, it's super helpful to be laser focused in the beginning. Principle number two, learning by doing. Consider two people. Person A is binge watching 50 hours of Udemy courses, starting all of these and finishing none of them, watching a couple of videos here, watching a couple of videos here, coming into the first problem, just trying out a new programming language because it doesn't work, then spending like half of the time in tutorial hell and mostly basically just watching best programming languages to learn in 2023 or something like this, and learning like data structures and algorithms and the difference between linked lists and arrays before even write like your first Hello World project. Then there's person B, who also watches a few courses, maybe like one or two, but immediately starts acting on the courses, maybe installing Unity already, trying out some projects, building the first Hello World, which in VR, the equivalent that I use a lot is like having a rotating cube basically that is deployed to your headset. So you can like put on your headset and you see like your first Hello World. And then you don't even know like any of these crazy details. You don't know like 50 different programming languages or like all of the details of the game engines, and you just start trying out and you are more practical about it. And who do you think, what person has the advantage here? I think this is a big problem with the whole education system, that there's so much like theoretical stuff and learning and consuming and passive watching and watch other people code instead of coding yourself. So I think having this practical approach, trying to build something fast, something small, and iterating over it, like you're not gonna build freaking GTA 6 on your first game anyways. So just having a cube that jumps up and down, for example, if you wanna build a game, or having a very, very, very basic VR scene where you can teleport around and then, I don't know, hit a cube and then you're good to go already. That stuff will teach you so much more than hundreds of hours of consuming stuff on the internet. It's the same with anything. Like, I mean, how do you learn freaking guitar? You learn guitar by not reading a book about it. You learn guitar by actually playing it. Or how do you learn sales? You learn sales by, well, cold calling people or trying to sell something, and not about hours of reading and consuming content. And especially for programming, since it is more difficult and more complex than most other fields, I think having gone through these like complex complex problem-solving chapters in your life, let's say, having the frustration and then having code not work and you don't know why, and then having code work but you still don't know why, but you're happy. All of these feelings, they are super important. And then, I don't know, for the first time going in a unmaintained and poorly documented and poorly written code base after 2 months and be like, what the fuck did I write there? Having all of these experience, they are part of being a developer, and these are super important. And also really important, being super scared of the feeling of making like a big Git merge or like a Git rebase and all of that stuff. So I think that is just like part of the journey. You can only live through it by actually doing it. Principle number 3, get a mentor. No matter how dedicated and how good you are, having somebody who has been there, who already is a successful XR developer, getting feedback from that person, especially on your code, getting code reviews, is extremely helpful. I think there's nothing that speeds up your learning curve more than having a mentor. And it should be somebody who's already walked the walk, basically. You don't want to get financial advice from somebody who's like 100,000 euros in debt or something like this. You don't want to get fitness advice from somebody who's 200 kilograms overweight. And you also don't want to get programming advice from somebody who can't code. So ideally, you have somebody who is in the XR field already, and I know it's pretty difficult, which is also why we at Immersive Insiders, my company, help out our students by exactly providing these like code reviews and having mentorships and stuff like this, helping our community. We have like dedicated teachers, and all of that stuff is stuff that I will link below so you can check it out. But again, you don't have to go through us. Find somebody who is competent, ideally in XR. If not, if that is like a good coder, it's also fine. If that person is genuinely helpful to you, or like willing to help you, basically, that is also really good. But finding somebody through your network, through your family, through your friends, through your peers is something that is probably the biggest leverage that you can take in speeding up your career. So once you have built a solid foundation of the knowledge, you have built some apps, you have built your portfolio, ideally also, I talk a lot about this in my other videos, you have kind of like, you know the knowledge, and now you are at the point where you want to apply to companies. One big mistake is that people don't prepare for the interview, and this is where this principle comes in: interview preparation. This is also where a lot of aspiring developers mess up. I won't go into too much depth on this part here because I think you will love it. We have a complete free roadmap course or roadmap guide for getting into AR and VR development. So that means really like from zero to hero, like all of these steps strategically you need to do to not waste any time. The fastest way really to become a XR developer, again, like in much, much, much more than like this short video. And we also have a dedicated chapter on like all of these interview questions. So I will read many of these like important ones, but again, you have like a full detailed list on a free course that we will link below on Immersive Insiders, of course. So if you're interested and if you like that kind of style of video and everything, and if you like my face, hopefully, then you will love the guide as well. But let's talk about some of the essential interview preparation tips. So first of all, of course, you want to have a good understanding of the job description. Really read exactly what it's needed, and ideally you can cross-check many of these things. For example, if they tell you you need to know about like hand tracking features for VR development, then well, learn about it. And then you need to know like about mixed reality, you need to know about GitHub and stuff like this. Of course, there will always be like these general things like teamwork and communication skills and stuff like this. Which again, it's extremely important, by the way. I'm not saying it's not important, but I think it's harder to specifically practice these, at least on a technical level. We will also talk about the soft skills later on, but I think having that like knowledge of what is needed specifically in that company, if you need to build a multi-user app, then of course you should have some multi-user samples at least, or like some prototypes that you have built to really be prepared for these like job interviews. Because the best thing you can do if you see like this, like required, 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 and optional, 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 if you like, the more you can check and the more you can communicate, hey, by the way, like this is required, look here what I built, and then that's gonna be sticking out positively really well. Next, you should practice like very common interview questions, and it's, I mean, we are also interviewing people. Like, we, of course, people are applying for immersive insiders as well, and we are hiring people and everything. So we get some of these applications, and I see like a lot of common mistakes also now when interviewing, which is people don't know how to reply or like how to answer like common questions, like tell me about yourself and like, hey, why do you want to work at our company, and what do you think about this field, and like really like basic stuff that is most likely asked all the time. And if there's some questions that you already know they are coming, you can prepare really well for them, actually, like your strength and weaknesses, all of these kind of things. So have like a Notion database of these common questions and have like a good answer, of course, like an authentic and honest answer for that, that you can just reuse all the time in the best possible way, instead of being like,
about myself, well, I like trains.
So that's not super helpful, you know? One thing that is gonna be probably the most helpful thing you can do for interviews is having interview simulations. So having like mock-up interviews with somebody. It can be some virtual person, it can be like a mentor, like on Immersive Insiders, but it can also be your big brother or somebody who's decently competent at like tech stuff. Even that person can, like with ChatGPT, can have like tech interview questions or something like this. You can throw in the description and then be like, hey, help me mock up this interview. You can give that sheet to some person and then really have a simulated interview. This will get you into the experience and make you a lot more confident and a lot more comfortable when this actually happens. So if you have a friend or something like this, hopefully, then actually just do it. Like that, I just came up with the idea, like just throw all of that stuff into ChatGPT, like the description, the questions, your some of your infos, and then you can basically get out the sample interview. You can print it out, give it to some friend, and then you can have a mock-up interview. I think this is going to be extremely helpful actually for you. And lastly, it's always good to have some prepared questions for the interviewer. And one nice trick that I can recommend you is a couple of questions that you can ask that person, which are generally really helpful, is something like, what can I do to become a super high performing, amazing hire, or something like this, like in the first 6 months? And then that has a lot of reasons. First of all, the interviewer sees yourself already working the company and you being amazing. I mean, there's like some psychology on that, of course, as well, but they see you already in a good light, and they will tell you like, hey, you will probably do this, you will do this, you would have done this one, you will work with this person really well, and all of these things. And you have a freaking checklist of things that you can do to really shine as well. So this is also even more helpful once you get the job. But these are things that that person sees, and you can actually positively reinforce these things. And you're like, I don't know, if that person says, hey, you must be good with MR, because MR is super important, mixed reality. And they're like, ah, yeah, I remember when I built my first MR project, was pretty cool. And then you just talk about these checklists that that person wants to have, or how you would do them. I think that is like one question that can be pretty good, for example. But again, have actually like genuine questions about the company, really. That is also helpful. Ask questions on who you will work with, because then you can maybe connect with them through LinkedIn and even like have a chit chat with them already before they decide on you. And then that person has a positive vibe about you already. Maybe, again, like just get creative in trying to ask questions that make the other person think, oh yeah, this person is actually proactive. If you get kind of this switch, that is gonna be super helpful. And yeah, I mean, I talked a lot already, so I think you will have much, much more detail in the free course below. If you're interested, thank you so much for listening. As always, if you have any questions, let me know, and I will see you in the next one.